Jacksonville, one of Florida's most historic cities, known for its buildings, banks, and bridges, is seen as a beautiful and well-developed part of Florida. When Jacksonville is mentioned by tourists, some may think of our beaches or museums, but there are many hidden historical parts of Jacksonville that some may not know about. I took the time to learn and visit a couple parts of Jacksonville that you may be surprised to learn are more than just some strange old building. I began my trip in downtown Jacksonville at 420 North Julius Street at what was once a complex known as the 310 West Church Street Apartments. This building, opening in 1924, was designed by Hintz, Reed, and Adler, an accomplished architectural firm known exclusively to Atlanta. This would be their only project done outside of Georgia throughout their careers. The building, a six-story, $300,000 brick and limestone complex, was designed in the shape of the letter H, so that every room would have a large window to look out of. It was able to house a little over 100 residents at a time. The 310 West Church Street Apartments, the first set of upscale apartments in downtown Jacksonville, was deemed to be a success, all of the apartments being rented out before construction was complete. The popularity of the apartments plateaued over the next 15 years, and in 1944, the 310 West Church Street Apartments became a hotel. In 1955, after three different name changes, it became what it is known as today, the Ambassador Hotel. By 1998, the building was known as a low-rent facility for tenants selling crack cocaine and prostitutes. In 1998, city safety code officials shut the hotel down for thousands of alleged violations, from poor sanitation to locked fire escapes. The building, still standing today, has had multiple plans for repair. In 2005, plans to remodel the building were announced, but then put on hold along with the courthouse plans. In 2009, plans were to change the Ambassador Hotel into the Ambassador Lofts, but because of the hefty estimated $8 million price tag, plans continued to be delayed. In 1983, it was added to the National Register of Historic Buildings, and 2014 marks 90 years since its opening. The project, once estimated to be completed in 2012, remains to be untouched, right in the middle of downtown Jacksonville. While downtown, I stopped at 112 West Adams Street, just a mere five-minute walk away, to Florida's oldest and largest banking organization, the Barnett Bank. The Barnett Bank was founded in 1877 by William B. Barnett, a banker from Kansas. William Barnett decided to move to Jacksonville in 1875 after visiting his oldest son, who moved here the previous year. Seeing how the health of his wife seemed to improve during their Florida fiesta, William decided to cut all of his previous ties and move to Jacksonville in 1877. Despite Jacksonville being in an economic recession at the time, having little to no transportation, and having a population of less than 10,000, William Barnett decided to use a capital investment of $43,000 to open the bank, Jacksonville's fourth at the time. In just 10 years, $11,000 of deposits skyrocketed to over $350,000. The following year, in 1888, Barnett applied for a bank charter, and Barnett Bank became the National Bank of Jacksonville. The bank continued to have great success over the years, becoming the only banking office still standing after the Great Fire of 1901. The Barnetts even allowed their competitors to keep their cash and valuables in their vaults while rebuilding. Sadly, William Barnett died in 1903, and his youngest son, Bion, moved from his managerial position to company president. In 1908, its bank charter expired, and the bank reopened as the Barnett National Bank, in honor of its founder. Its success made the need for expansion, and $1.5 million of construction made it the tallest building in Jacksonville. Even after Bion died in 1958, the bank continued to grow and expand. In 1997, a merger with Nations Bank Corp of Charlotte, North Carolina, worth $14.6 billion, made Nations Bank the largest bank in Florida and the third largest banking company in the country. Less than a year later, Nations Bank merged into the ever-relevant Bank of America. The third stop I took in the Springfield area of Jacksonville was to the Dr. Horace Drew residence at 3rd Street and Boulevard off Pearl. If you've ever visited the Springfield area, it's impossible to ignore this beautiful building. Built in 1909, this landmark was known as one of the most unique buildings of its time and still is a sight to see today. Dr. Horace Drew was the owner of downtown's H&WB Drew Company, one of Jacksonville's first newspaper plants and one of Jacksonville's first printing companies. The founder, Columbus Drew, moved here to Jacksonville in 1848 with his wife after having his first son, Horace. His plans to establish a newspaper, the Florida Republican, were successful until his newspaper plant was destroyed in 1854. 1 year later, he opened the Columbus Drew Stationery Printing Company. While serving in the Civil War, Columbus left his company in charge of his oldest son, Horace. Horace ran the company until their family was forced to leave Jacksonville because of war skirmishes over Lake City. Once the war ended, they returned to Jacksonville and Columbus was appointed Florida Comptroller, which is similar to a chief accountant or financial officer over the state. Being unable to manage both, Columbus sold the company to his son Horace in 1876. In 1886, Horace's brother William joined the company and the name changed to H. Drew & Brother, then to the H&WB Drew Company, Inc. in 1893. Horace continued as company president until his death in 1926. The business continued to be family ran until 1997, spanning through four generations, and as a result, the H&WB Drew Company was known as the oldest family business existent in Jacksonville. According to the Springfield Preservation and Revitalization Organization, try saying that five times fast, the mansion needs about $500,000 worth of work, and there's actually a buyer, but bag fines and legal issues are keeping it from being sold and renovated. The final stop on my trip around town took me to the Ann Little Elementary School, located in the Riverside part of Jacksonville. This school, originally named Riverside Park School, was built in 1891. What was then a small school shack needed to be rebuilt because of the population increase in the area. In 1915, Duval County voters passed a $1 million bond to build over a dozen new brick schoolhouses in the area. What was once Riverside Park School was rebuilt in 1918 and known as Public School No. 4. The $250,000 building was designed by architect Rutledge Holmes, an architect who moved to Jacksonville after the Great Fire of 1901. The school was known for its giant columns at the school entrance, its high ceiling classrooms, large windows, and the fireplace in the cafeteria. What was once a beautiful view overlooking the adjacent Riverside Park became obscured in the 50s with the construction of I-10 and I-95. The isolation of the school seemed to lead to its closure just 10 years later. The building then became office and storage space for the Duval County Public School System until 1971, when it was condemned and abandoned. After being vacant for 10 years, the building was sold for $168,000 to the Ida Stevens Foundation. Plans of converting the school into condominiums for senior citizens fell through after government subsidies dried up, and the building remained untouched. The building became a shelter for the homeless, which is suspected to lead to the building catching fire twice in 1955 and the roof of the auditorium caving in. In 2000, plans to demolish the building arose, and that same year, Jacksonville's Historic Preservation Commission granted the building landmark status. The building still stands today, mostly a canvas for graffiti, inside and out. A number of groups have tried to come together to donate their time in keeping the building manageable, but after a fire in 2012 reporting 90% of the building damaged, One must wonder if there's any alternative to demolition.